Here we go. I've gargled my nails and I'm ready for my close-up.
Jesus Christ.
What? Gargled your nails?
That's what it's... I sound like I've been gargling nails.
Gargling nails? I've never heard that
You've
expression.
You've never heard that expression? Yeah. Like,
no, you little weird super... Texan crown.
Shut up. That'd be like if I'm gargling whatever. It doesn't matter.
Anyway, well... I know how you are, a little sicky poo.
I'm a little sicky poo, but I rallied.
You did.
Wasn't going to skip this week.
We're drinking a soothing cocktail.
Yeah, this time we'll remember
well.
To say.
This evening, not morning.
Yeah, no. Which I'm kind of glad we're doing it this evening, and I don't think I could have drank something like this morning.
No.
Oh, sorry, everybody. That was horrible. I will. Oh, my God. Jesus.
Just put in, like, weird little, like, twinkle fairy dust sounds when, right? When you, like, inhale.
Inhale like I'm, like, doing blow. Jesus Christ.
Well, we are. Duh. What else would we be doing here?
Right. So you made me a little hot toddy, and I mean, it looks delicious. It tastes, the texture tastes on point, but I can't taste
the texture anything. Of the hot drink.
Yeah, I can't taste it. Yeah, so today, like, this is the second full day that I haven't been able to, like, taste anything. Like, anything. So, I haven't had an appetite. Because, I don't know, like, when you're sick, do you, like, when you don't, when you can't taste, you're not hungry. No. So,
just want to eat, ice cream.
Yeah, but even then, I was like, this is not satisfying. So... But my throat also kind of hurts, so I was like, all right, I'm going to go and just, like, eat some fucking garbage. So I went to Taco Bell, and, and it was, like, one of the ones that is connected to a KFC. And so I almost got, like, 2 bean burritos and some side of mashed potatoes.
But, oh.
I was like, no.
That actually,
34.
That sauce that's inside those burritos with mashed potatoes, god damn.
Jesus, I was like, no,
chili,
ma'am.
Chili cheese. Mashed potatoes.
Not hitting that rock bottom yet.
That might
so. Jesus Christ.
Oh.
So I said no. And then I just
said no, Linda.
Yep. And I gave them their 50 cents and I ate those. I'm pretty sure that they tasted just like they would if I had my taste buds. So, like, cardboard.
But at least you didn't get to taste it.
No. I was just trying to get something down so
just
I could...
kidding.
Not, yeah.
They're fine.
They're fine.
They're pretty.
It's whatever. What?
They're pretty good every once in a while.
Are we going to, like, kind of bash it? Like,
no.
Or not bash it? Like, hashtag sponsor us, Taco Bell.
I mean, you could. We would take it.
I mean, that's not a lie.
Hey, Crunchwrap Supreme. It's my favorite shit.
I'm not hating on Taco
Bell. Baja motherfucking Blast. Mountain Dew. Only place to carry it? Come on!
See, those things sound so good, but I know that they would just, like,
caramel apple empanada?
Oh, that does not sound good.
Oh my god, have you ever had one of those?
No. Again, I'm so sorry.
It's like a fucking McDonald's apple pie, but with caramel and cinnamon.
Oh.
I guess the apple pie.
I do like me some apple pies. Anyway, how are you?
Apple pie a la mode. I'm great.
Yeah?
I'm feeling great today.
Are you?
Yeah.
That's good. I'm glad. I hope you don't catch whatever
A lot of things are sneaking up on me, but it's all right.
Yeah, that's fair. Well, this serves me right because, like, I was joking about not having the SARS, and it was maybe even the corona.
We were close. We were close to the SARS, which apparently the coronavirus has killed more people than the SARS.
Yeah, I don't think...
The SARS.
I don't think you have to call it the SARS, but, like, yes.
I know. I like calling it the SARS.
It has surpassed SARS.
I know it's not called the SARS,
but it's the same.
Funny.
It's the same family.
Comedy.
Yeah. Oh, I got it.
The same family, but still the like we learned about SARS in, like, our history classes, being, like, a crazy fucking disease.
Yeah,
because
that happened in 2003, I believe.
SARS.
Mm-hmm.
No, that happened, like, back in the fucking day.
No, it happened in 2003. Look that shit up.
I'm
on your space
stupid.
Box over there.
Okay, never mind. I'm actually just realized what I'm thinking of.
What were you thinking of?
Nothing.
Okay.
Moving
Gross.
On. Coronavirus.
Mm-hmm. But anyway, so
you don't have it.
I don't.
If you
I'm,
have it. I'm probably going to.
It's in poor taste to joke about it. No, it's a whatever this is a horrible upper respiratory thing that I kind of wish, you know, I would. I don't even know. I can't even think words right now.
It's all right. Maybe after my presentation, you'll know what to do.
That's true. That's true.
Wink, wink. Just kidding. It's... What? Do you guys hear that fucking monster truck in Shay's neighborhood right now?
That's the new rally that we have to, instead of rent, we have to just take, we take turns with our cars.
Oh, that, you little drifters?
We have little drifters.
You have a drifting gang over here in the fucking... What's your neighborhood called?
Full of
trailheads?
No, that's the bar downtown. This is the outpost.
The outpost. It was something like that. Trailhead outpost.
Whichever.
There's a post at a trailhead. So that's what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of monster trucks, mm-hmm. I actually went to the Colorado Speedway the other day.
Oh, nice.
Yes, in the snow.
I got like to drive for fun?
No.
Oh, okay.
I got to drive my dad there because he had an arm surgery, and I got to drive him around the other day.
Okay.
That was one of the places he had to go.
I like that you said you got to instead of like you had to.
Dude.
I enjoy the spin on...
I spent the day driving around, like not the whole day.
But no. I enjoy the spin on it. It's a good spin.
I like to drive.
Do you really?
Yes.
Oh, God, I hate to drive.
I love driving.
Anyway, sorry, go on.
I like to be in control of the wheel.
I bet you do.
What? So anyways, we went to the Speedway, which I've never been to, and it made me really want to go there this year. So we're going to have to do a 30-ish report on the Colorado Speedway. My dad's going to be putting up like a bunch of big like stadium lights out there.
Well, that was the next question. Like, why were you out there?
We were just looking around.
Okay. So
we're
like
trying to find abandoned cars.
Oh, gotcha.
No. My dad's
he's doing a job out there.
Yeah, he's doing a job out there. And I was like, Dad, you should get some tickets. Wink, wink.
Wink.
Anyways, that was kind of random, but...
Nice.
I also
exciting.
Like, do they do, like, monster truck rallies in, like, the Speedway? But probably not.
I mean, I don't
know. No, it's
not
a Speedway. No, they don't speed around. That has to be, like, inside.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I guess it just all depends. They might.
It's a style, so...
It's just the style. You don't do it outside or anything.
Yeah. Anyway.
Oh,
by the way, I'm Bree, and this is Shay, and this is 30-ish podcast, if you didn't know that already. Also, we're drinking hot toddies. I hope you guys enjoyed how we told you our last,
'cause I forgot.
Last week's episode. We never told you what drink we were drinking, so I hope you enjoyed Shay
just
personally telling you.
Yes, I knocked on every single one of your doors.
That, but I really was excited about that part of our podcast last week.
It's the small things that we treasure.
It is. And if there are any small things that you treasure, just let us know.
And we will treasure them with you.
We will.
Yeah.
We'll answer your questions.
They'll become our treasures.
Yes.
Okay.
Our precious treasures.
Yes.
So, today we both rolled science.
We did.
And it's going to be a hoot of a time.
It sure is. I don't know if mine is going to teach anybody anything. But it's just some interesting facts.
That's fun.
Yeah, it's a little terrifying, actually, but it's cool. But like terrifying and like not like, oh my. Never mind.
We'll find out.
Yeah, we'll just find out.
I'm scared.
Trying to.
So yours is like paranormal and science.
It is not paranormal. Absolutely not. It's very
scary in different ways.
It's yeah.
Great.
Like humans are just fucking bizarre creatures, but
we are.
We are. Anyway, you want to jump into it?
Yeah.
Let's do it.
I guess it's time. Time for our chime.
No, that's not till later.
Oh, fuck. I hope you guys heard me breathing or salivating. Just kidding. I really wanted Shay to do an ASMR so she understands what it is.
Yeah.
And that's...
I know we've talked about it.
That is just a hint of the wide world of ASMR.
Yeah, I know we've talked about it, but again, she reiterated that, like, people get paid thousands of dollars to do that unless, like, this. And then she's like, you have to just record it.
We should have a contest where, like, we'll do something random and people have to guess it. And if they guess it, we'll give them a sticker.
Oh, a sticker.
and a high five. And then when we're sponsored by Taco Bell, we'll give them a Baja Blast and a caramel and a bag
for their diarrhea. Jesus Christ.
God. Here's 6 free tacos. Please pass them around and don't eat them all in one sitting.
But here's because the scratch and sniff sticker for when you need to have like a little air freshener when you're tooting.
We need scratch and sniff 30-ish. Oh. Duh. 30-ish scratch and sniff.
It's the fever brain in me. Write it down.
Oh my God. Where's your notebook? Shut up.
No, where's your notebook? Write it down. I'm not even kidding. Well, Brett, you have like you literally have a virtual notebook in your fucking lap.
I have it. I know what I'm going to write it on. Hold on. Give me this. Okay. Here we go. Keeping notes. 30-ish. Nope. What was I doing?
30-ish. Scratch and sniff stickers. Perfect.
Okay, time for story time.
That's why we're here.
Science.
News Part one.
Hour.
Part one.
30-ish edition.
Part one. All right.
Because it's a double whammy. And today is a double whammy of science. So within my double whammy, are you ready for this inception? I'm going to up you one more double whammy, and I'm going to talk about food science.
Ooh.
And specifically, we're going to talk about the science of bitters.
Okay. Which is in my drink, like you were saying.
Yes. We made hot toddies, like we said earlier, but today I added a little something extra, and mm-hmm. I added a little bitters to it to help mm-hmm. some extra things for Shay, and also because they're delicious, and not that Shay can taste them, but I think they're delicious. And just a couple drops will do ya.
Yep.
But I'll tell you more about that in just a minute.
I can't tell if it's the bitters or the whiskey that's making it very strong. I guess it's the whiskey.
It's probably the whiskey.
Yeah.
Because I didn't put very many in yours.
I can feel the heat of the whiskey.
Just a few bitter.
But I can't taste anything. It's insane. Go on. Sorry. I'm just still, my mind is blown.
You're fine.
That I can't taste it.
Wow, I just rediscovered how I need to hold my shit. Is this good?
That's great.
Does it sound good? Hello? Yeah. Testing? You're testes.
You sound great.
Okay. So. Okay, my eyes.
Okay.
Can we turn a light on? My eyes are weird. No, I'm just kidding.
Do you really want a light?
No.
I mean, just so everyone knows, we're not like sitting in the dark, by the way.
We're sitting in our red light.
Yeah, we're not sitting in the darkness.
I can't see shit because I feel like a reptile. Just kidding. Okay, so bitters, okay?
Okay.
So bitter, as itself, is an uncommon flavor that has largely disappeared from our modern palate. Obviously, we do have some bitter components in our food mm-hmm. that we eat, you know, nowadays, but... Right. We used to eat a lot more bitter shit, and we were a lot healthier.
Hmm.
So bitter foods and herbs were a very common part of our ancestral diets as well. Not even just like a couple hundred years back, like thousands of years back.
Okay.
It's amazing they weren't making like fucking old fashions for each other in caves, but they were eating bitter foods and...
Can you imagine?
And that'd be sweet. Here's your Sazerac.
Right.
And a club in the face.
This fight.
Could you imagine a bar fight back then with fucking like saber-toothed tiger teeth?
Right. Just like.
Fucking necklaces and shit.
That'd be amazing.
So it's amazing. Like, it's just amazing what our ancestors intuitively knew.
Yeah, about, they could listen to their guts because it wasn't fucked up.
And they could literally listen to their guts mm-hmm. and knew that this shit was helping their guts.
Yeah.
And. They were like, they didn't have to fucking do a bunch of research to know that. Right. And I just think that's really amazing that we're now like adapting things from our ancestors that right. like they just fucking knew was good for you. Right. You know what I mean?
They didn't have the goddamn Google back then.
Yeah. And they weren't like, they didn't have the fucking like power hungry greed that makes them think that they, I don't know.
Yeah. Just whoever was in charge of bedrock.
Mm-hmm, so. Exactly. I can make your bedrock. Yep. Oh, that's the best bedrock song.
He is the best one.
Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the best
song? No, it's Better not.
No.
Keep going.
So, bitters are still used in Chinese medicine and Ayurvedic medicine and practices. Have you ever heard of Ayurvedic?
I have.
Mm-hmm.
I worked at Gaia.
I'm
just joking. I'm sorry. I'm busting your balls.
You know that shit, though. So if you don't know what Ayurvedic medicine is, it's one of the world's oldest holistic healing systems, and it's based on the belief that health and wellness depend on a delicate balance between your mind, body, and spirit.
Yes.
Not just like your body, not just your mind.
What a fucking concept.
If you're fucking feeding your mind good shit and you're eating shit.
Like Taco Bell.
You're gonna still feel like shit.
With a mashed potato.
Mashed potato.
See, it makes me
stupider. Mashed potato burrito. If you're eating mashed potato burritos, but you're going to therapy, you might not get the results you're wondering. Just kidding.
Anyway, sorry.
You don't eat mashed potato burritos every day, and you didn't even eat one today.
No, thank God. I was like, no.
Mashed potato burrito. Oh, my God. What have I begun? So, back to bitters, bitch.
Sorry.
That's literally my notes, which I knew we were going to get off topic.
That's amazing. That is fucking fantastic.
I'll fucking take a picture of it because...
That's pretty on point. How would you have known? Like, I don't even remember what you said.
Well, it's because I was talking about Ayurvedic medicine. Oh, so okay. I was like, back to bitters, bitch. But like, that's literally what I needed to do. Anyways, back to bitters, bitch. Apparently, we found out that we have what's called a bitter reflex in our bodies. And basically, the taste of bitter on the tongue starts to stimulate in the brain. Stimulates the brain to release the digestive hormone gastrin. It also starts up a bunch of different actions in the body, which preps our digestive system for the food that we're about to eat. Mm-hmm. So they just are recently finding this out, and it's only produced by bitter flavor and sensation.
Shit.
So specifically, these
is that why berries are bitter? Sorry, I'm thinking out loud. My bad. Go on. Sorry.
That's the tannin. I don't know. What?
No, just keep going.
Okay.
Sorry.
So specifically, these different actions that it starts up are neural and endocrine actions, which I talked about endocrine when I was talking about blue light with our hormones, all our hormone regulation system in our bodies. Mm-hmm. So things like appetite stimulation, release of digestive enzymes. It aids in liver detoxification. Mm-hmm. That's pretty good for our drinkies.
Yeah, nice.
Stimulating mechanisms to repair the gut well. Some other shit to help our sphincter and some other gross other shit that you can Google if you want to learn some deeper info about what else.
Pun intended.
The bitter reflex, once it is activated, what it does in our body.
Okay.
So, let's talk about some bitter foods real quick.
Okay.
So, some bitter foods include my favorites, cruciferous vegetables. So, like, your broccoli, your Brussels sprouts, arugula,
I do like that
cauliflower.
Shit. Those are considered bitter.
Those are considered bitter foods.
Okay.
Dandelion greens, cranberries, cocoa or cacao.
Okay.
Green tea, celery is also considered...
I wouldn't think celery would be.
Well, it has the same properties as these bitter foods does. So I don't know if it's technically a bitter food, but it has the same actions in the body. Celery has been known
That makes sense.
Also have these things. And then also citrus peel.
Oh, and that's in here too.
That's in there, bitch. You gotta chew on that.
Oh, no. That sounds awful.
Some other things that... Oh, some bitter herbs include dandelion, burdock... gentian, which is in widely known bitters.
That's okay.
The cocktail bitters
mm-hmm.
that I'm mainly going to be talking about in a little bit. Artichoke is considered a bitter herb. Chamomile, milk thistle, golden seal, chicory, endive, Peppermint is even a moderate bitter.
Really? Herb. I do not like peppermint.
What? Good thing I didn't get that.
Not a big
fan.
Oh, you
like spearmint?
I like spearmint. I do not like peppermint. Mm. But, again, okay. Can't taste it, so, right now, in my life.
So, bitters in tinctures or drinkable form have been used since prehistoric times as well.
Woo! Tasting like hot, though. Woo-woo.
And that's mainly what I'm going to be talking about today.
Nice.
So bitters are known to impart good health preserved in a neutral liquor. So bitter infusions of medicinal plants are still widely used to treat and prevent illness in healthcare systems around the world, even. Today, approximately 7,000 modern medicines are derived from bitter plant medicines.
Uh-huh.
Hell yeah. And bitters have a variety of uses and are classified based on how they physiologically affect the human body. So there's like tons of different ways they can help us. So I'm going to talk about a couple of those things. But first, I'm going to talk about how they're made.
Okay.
Like the actual, like, not like the bitters that we're going to be talking about, the liquid form.
Okay.
So bitters are made by infusing a neutral spirit with any number of aromatics. Like it can be... I mean, different things will cause different ingredients will cause different things to happen, and sometimes you shouldn't mix certain amounts of things, but you can pretty much make bitters out of whatever the fuck you want.
Right.
But including aromatics, spices, tree bark, roots, seeds, fruit,
whatever.
Many things. As bitter herbs are considered cold in nature, they're often combined with warming herbs such as cinnamon, cardamom, and ginger to balance the formula. So... that's usually what you'll get when you have, like, a bitters tonic or tincture or something like that. You'll have – it'll be, like – it definitely has that warming effect, but it is bitter, which is technically considered to be a cold sensation in your body. Because there's different things – there's different foods that are considered hot or cold, not necessarily based on their temperature.
Right. That makes sense.
Anyway.
That makes sense.
So – and you can also, like, those kinds of foods, like, I'll have to do a food podcast on that, but, like, it, like, makes sense. Like, oh, cinnamon, cardamom, and ginger are warming herbs. That makes sense. They're, like, when you eat them, they kind of make you feel, like, warm and spicy. They're, like, more herbs you find in the winter and fall times, you know? So it's kind of stuff like that. It's pretty neat.
That's pretty
cool. And that's all about Ayurvedic medicine, I think. Like, Ayurvedic eating is all about that, too.
Right.
And Chinese medicine and...
absolutely.
So bitters help accentuate, bitters and drinks help accentuate other tastes like sourness or sweetness and give your drink more depth of flavor. And that's mainly what they're used for in your cocktail.
That's for true.
And it helps you out also at the same time.
Yeah, getting your drink
on. So let's first talk about digestive bitters. So they obviously, you can probably tell by their name that they support digestion. And they soothe the somewhat annoying things that come along with digestion, such as constipation, gas, bloating, loose stools, food allergies, acid reflux, upset stomach, diarrhea.
I was like, is this the thing for Pepto-Bismol? I don't understand.
Fuck Pepto-Bismol, which is another thing I wrote.
Yeah, that's because shit disgusting.
Get yourself some bitters, bitches.
Yeah, that shit will block you up.
Block you up.
Block you
so,
right up. It's like chalk. Not that I know what chalk tastes like.
You do. But you know. Don't. We all know what chalk tastes like.
We all licked it one time.
But, like, you can, you that know what it tastes like by the smell.
Only twice.
It's, you know.
I mean, that too. Yeah, didn't lick it. I never licked it.
Oh, we licked it. Oh, I definitely licked it. I definitely took a chalk. Are you kidding me? I'm pretty sure everyone's taken a fucking bite out of a chalk stick.
I don't know if you've taken a bite out of it. I've licked it. I don't know if I've... bit it like a candy bar.
Yeah, maybe I thought it was like a Smarty stick.
Oh.
Or like one of those candy cigarettes. Actually, I definitely didn't think it was. I just wanted to try chalk.
That's fair.
Look it's okay. at me now.
My uncle tricked me one time to eat like cat food. Like, and I tasted that, and it's not very good. I don't know how they can eat the same meal every single
day. Yeah, dog food was far superior to cat food.
Really? I've never tasted dog food. Anyway, back to bitters, bitch.
And dog bones.
What?
Yeah, I'm a freak. That's why I'm a chef, so probably, that I don't have to eat dog bones and cat food.
Yeah, that's why.
That's the main reason. My parents were like, oh my God, please, Lord. We need a teacher. We need to teach her something else.
Give her some peanut butter and jelly. It wasn't jelly, that big of a Jim.
Problem, but I was known to sneak in the garage and eat a dog bone sometimes.
Wait, so you actively would sneak
in? Yeah, like multiple times. I definitely ate dog bones.
Did you
bones.
Just like the saltiness? Or was it salty?
They tasted like, I would literally tell people they tasted like breadsticks to me. And by people, I mean my parents when they'd be like, why did you eat another goddamn dog bone?
Oh, wait, but was it like an actual bone or like a milk bone?
Like a milk bone.
Oh, okay. It wasn't like a like dog bone. Like
not a fucking raw dog bone. Not like gnawing on the rug. I don't have to go outside or anything. Actually, I did have to go outside because that's where the dog bones were.
You did.
It definitely wasn't a style. It was a
thing. It was like it was a whole addiction. Position and a whole thing. Holy fucking shit. So it was a milk bone. Okay, that makes more sense.
Yeah, I would they're believe, salty and
I would believe that because I feel bready. Like they're made just...
Fucking nasty ass shit in there. I was chomping down. Fucking 5 years old.
Eating like a Scooby snack.
I used to pretend I was a dog a lot, too, so maybe that had something to do with it.
But you just didn't know the edge of, like, pretend and make-believe.
I mean, I knew I was a human, but I still wanted dog bones because I thought they tasted good.
No, I knew you were a human, but, like, we were like, these are just good. I'm just
you
like,
you knew
well.
I was.
The whole time.
All right, back sorry. To bitters, bitch. Anyway. That is literally the theme of the of
my that's the story. Title of the show, so it's fine.
Back to bitters, bitch.
Back to bitters, bitch.
Okay, so digestive bitters. Fuck Pepto-Bismol. Is that where I left off?
Yep.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. So digestive bitters also encourage digestive secretions, which in turn helps you absorb the most nourishment available in all the healthy food you're eating. So helps you get all the good shit out of the food you got.
Okay.
You're just shoveling down your throat.
Down your gullet.
Helps you get everything good out of them. Mm-hmm. So they can be taken before or after a meal, depending on the function and the flavor. Okay. And many digestive bitters are taken before the meal to prepare the body for eating. And other digestive bitters with strong aromatic profiles are taken after the meal to help digestion, as well as to help freshen breath.
Okay. I like that.
Excuse me. As I burp,
it's fine. I'm smacking in the microphone.
America's burrito. I had a burrito too for dinner.
Yeah, you had a better one for sure.
I did have a better burrito. But I literally live next door to this sweet Mexican market. And I also got, and it's also a Mexican bakery, and I got this thing called a quesadilla.
Yeah.
And it was not a fucking quesadilla, guys. But it was good. It's a dessert.
I mean,
it's like a pound cake, cheesecake.
The texture was really nice. I couldn't taste it.
So good. Anyways, back to bitters, bitch. We're talking about medicinal bitters now.
Okay.
So the bitterness of bitters mostly comes from some well-known phytochemical classes. And if you don't know what phytochemicals are, just to refresh your memory, it's chemical compounds produced by plants that help them thrive, ward off competitors, predators, and other pathogens in themselves. Okay. And they're also found to benefit human health.
Ooh.
So they do those same kinds of things in us.
So nice.
Isn't that nice? Plants are so nice to us and we just rip them out of the ground and don't say thank you.
No, we don't.
Don't honor what we do with them.
We don't.
We just cut them up and shove them in a machine and freeze them and frostbite them and fucking fry them and eat them in 4 seconds in our car.
Yep. That's exactly what we do.
That's everything.
America.
Okay. So anyway. So all of these phytochemicals are also known for health benefits, including having antifungal, antiseptic, antidepressant, cardioprotective, hormone regulating, immune boosting, and blood sugar regulating properties.
Damn.
To name a motherfucking few.
Oh, shit.
And yeah, so the bitterness of the bitters comes from these phytochemicals that are doing all these cool things in our body for us.
Shit. Who knew?
Who the fuck knew?
Who knew?
Well, now you know. So among the most powerful effects for preventative health are antioxidant and anti-inflammatory activity. And because inflammation can lead to chronic diseases and types of cancer, it's not surprising both botanists and doctors are looking to bitters for answers and help.
That's awesome.
And they're finding that it's helping prevent different things. It's definitely a huge talk in the preventative health space right now, too.
That's awesome.
So less than 20% of commonly used medicinal plants have been researched for their legitness to work. And even among those that have been researched is another story when they come to be mixed in bitters. So, like, we're just now learning the benefits of, like, all these different weird concoctions of bitters. And, like, now we're realizing, like, these little, you know,
right,
like, potions.
Like, right.
They're actually, yeah, they're fucking helping us.
Right.
And for different reasons. So example, a bitters made of whole herbs of caraway, fennel, and anise is known to have help with, people with spasms. And, but the isolated essential oils of each of the plants do not have this function at all and can even induce the opposite effect when used just themselves. So it's crazy that in a tincture in this, like,
right,
in this bitters form, like, putting it in this, like, alcohol, or, like, it's basically a tincture. That's what a tincture is. It's having this different effect than it would on its, you know,
right,
in another way.
Which is crazy.
It's really
fucking
neat.
Fucking science.
Fucking sweet. So bitters are also used for stress. There's a long history of botanicals being used for their anti-anxiety and relaxant properties. And aptogenic bitters, which I don't know if you've been hearing about adaptogenic everything nowadays, like adaptogenic mushrooms are really big in the adaptogenic properties. But adaptogenic bitters are also can be adaptogenic, and they boost your body's ability to adapt and recover, improving your general well-being. The most common adaptogenic ingredients are ashwagandha, American ginseng, and Siberian ginseng. And these are just some to name a few. What? Fuck, I deleted something in there.
It's fine. I've done that. When I'm like, oh, guess I said no to that thought.
So some of these other bitters relieve anxiety and apprehension without affecting your body's mental or physical state, which... some like drugs that you get for anxiety, like you can't drive, or like depending on how bad it is, or like you can't like it does, it's like using a bitters, or you know, the specific kind of bitters will not have that kind of effect on you, and it's natural.
Okay.
Sedative plants in general can function as analgesics, which basically is a pain reliever. And common examples are found in bitter tonics, including hops, valerian, wormwood, chamomile, and mugwort.
Ooh, mugwort.
Mugwort! Sounds like fucking Harry Potter.
That's exactly what it sounds like.
There are also nervine remedies, which means the plants have a calming effect on the nerves and stress.
Okay.
So, bitters also... promote overall healthy eating habits and control overeating by stimulating the production of the hormones PYY. I don't know why I want to say it like that. And GLP-1, which help control and suppress appetite. Bitters also help curb sugar cravings by countering the brain receptors that make us want sweets. And they can... And that's about it.
Perfect. and specific, that's all, folks.
Specific bitters for sugar and appetite control.
That's pretty cool. Apparently
are licorice root, citrus peel,
I'll do that.
Artichoke leaf, and gentian root. So just drink some bitters.
Yeah.
Gentian. I'm not saying that right. So you should be careful, though. Kids, because if you are on any medication,
yes,
if you're on any medication, bitters can interact or affect the absorption of those medications. So, be careful with that.
What
are you on medication?
No, good. I was just going,
Oh, I thought you were like, oh no,
oh no, that would be going,
oh
shit. Yeah, no,
So medicinal plants used in bitters can also have adverse effects if used incorrectly, such as through overdose or improper preparation. But basically, just don't buy your bitters off eBay and, I mean, like, know what you're doing. Follow a recipe if you're making it yourself that's, like, trusted. And just buy, I mean, a trusted brand that's, like, sold in a trusted store. Exactly. Don't be a dummy.
Don't. Basically. Just don't be stupid.
And don't talk to strangers.
I was, like, going to say, okay, like, that's a good rule of thumb just in any area
exactly.
of life.
Exactly.
Don't get in vans. I mean, exactly. unmarked ones. Mm-hmm. I mean, if there's, like, a church thing on it, like, I mean, I'm sure that's fine. Mm-mm. But even then, I don't even know.
No. You can't trust anything. So, now let's get to drinking, shall we? The drinking bitters.
Done that.
So, many popular brands of bitters began as medicinal tonics, but have now evolved into cocktail bitters. So, yeah, so a lot of the popular brands... I just said all that.
Okay, that's your finest hipster bars.
Exactly. So even though you only use a drop or a dash at a time, it acts as a concentrated flavor stimulant to add a nice little kick to your drink. And seriously, you just need to use it in a drop or a dash.
That makes sense.
Aromatic bitters are the old standard. This is like the main type of bitters you'll find. And to this day is the best known and most frequently used. The most iconic maker of aromatic bitters is Angostura, which I'm sure everyone has seen.
I mean, maybe. Probably.
So they're basically named for a Venezuelan city where they were created, but...
Fancy.
They actually are not made from the bark of the Angostura tree, which you would think that's why it's named that, and it's made with bark and stuff, but it's not made with that. Mm. And since the recipe is a tightly guarded secret, no one even knows if it ever was made with that type of bark. So basically the story goes that a German doctor found himself in Venezuela in 1824, where he created his secret blend of tropical herbs and plants with the intent of curing a variety of illnesses. And the brand is now produced in Trinidad, and the blend is still a well-kept secret. And the oversized awkward label has become a trademark of the brand. So if you've ever seen those bitter bottles with like the label that's like the label goes over like the bottle, like where the neck goes in, like the label still like picks up.
Yeah.
So that's like kind of what they're known for.
Oh.
And
it
said that the wrong size was ordered, and everyone in the facility thought someone else would fix the mistake, and no one did. And that's why the label is still like that, and it just stuck.
That's weird. But okay.
Who knows if that's a real story?
I like
There's also another really famous aromatic bitters called Picards. That was developed by a pharmacist and Creole immigrant, Antoine Amédée Picard, in New Orleans. And his family would put his bitters in cognac from his pharmacy in the French Quarter.
Ooh.
And then because of that, people started asking for his bitters by name at the bars throughout the city because people would get a taste and want some more.
So fucking good.
And today, Picard's bitters are synonymous with the Sazerac cocktail, Sazerac de Forge et Fille, which is...
Man,
basically a Sazerac cocktail, which is like one of the oldest known American cocktails.
Damn.
And that's basically
like a mouthful.
Yes. So most get their flavor from most of our cocktail bitters get their flavor from bitter roots, especially the gentian root. And then a blend of warm spices like cinnamon, cardamom, or cloves, and a proprietary mix of herbs or other botanicals such as tamarind, wormwood, and barks. And that's basically what makes up bitters.
Okay.
The next most popular bitters besides aromatic is citrus bitters. They've been making orange bitters. That's like the next most popular thing you can find.
I think I've had that more than anything is orange bitters.
And there's also a lot of there's lots of craft bitter companies out there now. You can find a lot of locally made bitters or ones that aren't, the mass produced kind. And one such company I just wanted to give a shout out to is this company called Dram. It's Dram Apothecary, and they're in Salida now, but it's actually
Oh, nice.
This girl I used to work with at a restaurant, and her name is Shay.
Damn, that's because we're so badass.
And she was always a badass bartender, and she, like, she went to, like, she's, like...
Like a botanist? Like an
herbalist school, yeah. And, like, whatever, but...
That's awesome.
I don't know for sure.
She's a leader of the plants.
School. But, yeah, she is, and she, like, forages, like, the mountains of Colorado and...
Damn.
Like, for a lot of the stuff she uses to make her bitters, and her company started as a bitters company, and now she's... grown on to do, like, now she does CBD sparkling waters, and she does adaptogenic drops and, like, CBD adaptogenic drops, so, like,
shit.
But she does a lot of stuff with bitters still too, and her bitters are fucking awesome, and she has really cool flavors. One of her flavors she has is called the hair of the dog, which I didn't realize.
Can you guess what that is?
Yeah, it's for your hangover.
Yeah,
and I didn't realize the story behind hair of the dog, and I thought it was kind of interesting. Basically, hair of the dog, if you ever have heard of it, is basically any alcohol you drink.
Yeah.
After you've drank the night before.
After you drunk, you drunk.
It's supposed to help with your hangover.
Right.
Her bitters, and she makes a bitters, like, for this. Right. So, and it's called hair of the dog. But an ancient... So the phrase comes from the expression hair of the dog that bit you, meaning the best cure for what ails you is to have some more of it. Hmm. In ancient times, it was literally used to say that if a dog were to bite you, putting the dog's hair into the wound would heal it.
Hmm.
Handcrafted. Weird. Yes. Isn't that weird?
Yes, that's very weird.
Yeah, I just thought that was interesting.
I love it. Just like, yeah, you know what? You know what would do really well for that infection? Some dirty dog hair. Put it in there. Mat it up.
Yeah, that's really gonna work.
But anyway. I get it. That's just what it's about. It was about stories back then.
To make you stronger.
But that's interesting. That's where that came from.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's all. Then she also has, a bunch of different bitters. Like, she has, like, a wild mountain sage bitters. Mm-hmm. And then she also has a Palo Santo bitter.
I mean, everything that she's, just the names sound cool. Really fancy and amazing, and I would...
And the
them.
Labels are beautiful.
Of course
and they're
are.
Beautiful to look at.
That's what it matters is the packaging, I'm telling you.
So there's also another type of alcoholic bitters, but they're potable bitters, which is a liqueur or an amari. And so they're not quite as potently flavored as cocktail bitters,
mm-hmm.
But they still do the same thing. Like, it's like an aperitif, like... Okay. After dinner kind of drink.
Right.
And the term potable means that these bitters aren't too strong to be consumed alone. So, like, a vermouth or a Campari. So a couple different types of bitter alcohols. So, like, a potable bitter, which is not, like, you can tell the difference by, like, a bitters, like, a cocktail bitters are in the tiny little bottles, and they mm-hmm. usually come with a little dropper.
Right.
A potable bitter, uh-huh. like a what I'm talking about now, those come in big bottles. So, like, Aperol is a bitter.
Right.
So that's like orange, rhubarb, and gentian.
Like, I feel like I've seen that one, yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Aperol spritzes are, like, fucking everywhere.
Yeah.
This last, like, year or two.
So fucking fetch.
Campari is another one. It's famously ruby red grapefruit bitter drink and very floral.
Uh-huh.
And one of my favorites that one of my favorite fucking drinks I've ever had in my entire life mm-hmm. was at Williams and Graham in Denver, mm-hmm. which is like a quote-unquote speakeasy. It's fucking dope. If you've never been there, you guys should definitely go.
I'm sure it's pretty cool.
You basically walk into a fucking like a desk with a bookshelf, and then they open the bookshelf and you go in, and it's like really old school looking. Anyways, best drink I ever had there had a bitter in it called Chinar. And
sounds expensive.
It's made with artichokes and 13 herbs and botanicals, which sounds fucking weird as fuck, but it's so herbal and like just really herby and yummy and
delicious.
Good. And this drink had Chinar, like basil, lime, like simple syrup, and like just a fuck ton of basil, and like think maybe mint. And it was like the just most refreshing, good. Delicious.
It's like a
drink
basil
ever.
Bush. Like it.
Yes. So, how did you get some bitters in your life?
Mm.
So, bitters are a very potent and dosing and frequent. Bitters are very potent. And the dosing and the frequency will vary on what you're using them for, but often just a few drops will do. I feel like, I don't know for sure, maybe do some more research yourself, but like you could probably have like a couple drinks with, I'm not saying like a couple alcoholic drinks, but like right. make yourself a little fucking Topo Chico with some bitters in it.
Right.
You know, couple of those a day.
Just a spoonful of bitters.
You can take them internally either by placing a few drops of the tincture on your tongue or diluting them with another liquid such as sparkling water or in cocktails like we did tonight.
Right, make it fancy.
When you take it might matter though. So if your goal is to use the bitters to ease digestive issues, you should take them directly before or after your meal, okay. not like during your meal. How often you take them differs for everyone. You can use bitters at low doses as part of your daily routine, or you might find that bitters help you when you just use them like when you just need them.
Right.
So it just depends. Everyone's different. We're all different, guys. We all have to figure it out for ourselves. And just like anything, it's obviously good to start with small doses. Like, mm-hmm. don't fucking chug a bottle because that's dumb and your taste buds will be fucked up for a little bit, too.
Right.
Because they're, it'll be very strong.
Don't do it.
And that's about all I got for you.
I like it, though.
So for a lot of people, bitters provide a lot of health benefits when taken before meals and when drank as a tonic. And basically, go check them out for yourself.
Get after it.
And add some depth to your cocktails, if anything.
I mean, that's true.
Or help your fucking constipation.
I mean, or that.
Or your anything. Lots of things. Your upset stomach, your diarrhea.
All those things.
And that's all I got.
But without having to drink chalk.
No.
For real this time.
Don't eat chalk. Don't.
Or dog biscuits.
Don't do Pepto-Bismol. I mean, you can.
I mean, you do what you want.
But Pepto-Bismol is like fucking gross and it like
makes my stomach hurt already.
Like coats your fucking mouth too.
I think that's the point. Anyway.
It's gross.
Ready for some more science?
I'm ready. Oh, did you roll science? It's time after the chat. I forgot my rhyme.
Are we done?
Yeah, we're done. I wanted to do an ASMR, but mine wasn't as cool. Could you guess what that was, guys? It was a fucking, what is this, Nintendo 64?
I know. Yeah.
It's controller, mm-hmm. button pushing.
Yeah. Could you tell which spasm it was?
I better get my bitters for my spasms.
You better.
Mm-mm-mm. For my spasms on this Nintendo 64 controller.
Oh my God, that you were just frantically right. pushing.
What are we talking about now?
I liked it.
What could we be talking about now?
I actually labeled my paper shitty science.
Literally
not
shitty?
not like the
poop?
No. Not that. Good. These are just some shitty like just science
scientists.
Yeah. Oh my God. They're not shitty scientists. It's just
dumb scientists.
So, for me, for science, since you might not have any topics that give you a hard time, but for me, science is just one of
all
them.
All of them.
No, but like you probably have.
I'm glad I fake it so well.
Shut up. You probably have like I. Okay, my mucus is really taking hold.
Mucus brain. Hashtag mucus brain.
Hashtag mucus brain. I don't know if you're like me, where some like all of our topics, like I liked obviously like to do the history and I like to do the homicide and I like to do the like the nostalgia. Those are the ones that I really like to do. So when I get science, it kind of trips me up a little bit. So I had to kind of make it, and I'm doing it in a different way where I had to make it fun so it's not like an assignment for myself.
Exactly, so. And that is a very beautiful analogy for life.
Yes, so
you got to make it work for yourself, just like.
It's true. So I have to go down the road of like giving you like, for instance, like this week, I'm going to do like a couple stories. There's like three different stories that I'm doing that just because they weren't long enough just to be a story within themselves. And they are just some of the weirdest shit people used to do or believe before like science started into town. So, and again, I
science rode into town.
I apologize because I am so clogged up that if I'm going to probably fumble over words, but I mean, I do that anyway. But you know what I mean.
Fine.
I'm going to take this out of my mouth though.
Perfect. That was much better. Still.
Yeah. Except I'm dropping it on my carpet.
Your halls.
Ah, how can something like you can't taste, but it's so spicy in your mouth? It's so weird. Okay. Anyway. All right.
The halls.
Yeah, it's I'm all fucked up. Okay, anyway,
Shay's on mushrooms right now, so
I wish because then maybe I could at least taste something like colors.
Doing that? Is that going to be our 100th episode? We just could. Do mushrooms.
100th. Let's what do our 50th. Number
are we?
We're pretty close.
Past our 50th.
No, we're not. We're almost not? Our 50th. I think this is like our 44 or 45th.
Oh my god!
So we could do it for our 50th. If we go to that thing over at the museum. I don't know if I could do that.
I couldn't do that. Yeah. I want to be alone first.
Yeah.
I don't want to go to
show. For your very first time on mushrooms, we're going to really just like make you go into a giant, giant hole and never come out again.
Yeah. Has anyone gone to this Mesoamerica thing?
My roommate did, and she said it was amazing.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to go. Okay. Bye.
Okay. Bye. Okay.
Okay. Here we go.
So let's start off with the first one. Like a first. Well, of course we're going to start off with the first one, because it's the first one.
What? You Jesus have to Christ. Introduce the first okay. one.
So let's start off with the classic. Washing your hands won't prevent disease. Belief. That was...
Oh, these are like science urban legends.
Yeah, this is like what wrong, people believed.
Horribly wrong.
And then, you know, science then rode into town and was like, you guys are all idiots. Oh. But anyway. So this ripe old thought form didn't become like a thing of the past till like 1850, though. So it wasn't until, but even then, like, well, just come along with the journey with me. It'll be fine. Okay.
I'm hopping on board.
Oh, toot. A toot. Okay. That's a train. Okay. So anyway. That's a train.
A toot. A toot.
A toot. A toot.
That's really loud. Sorry.
In 1850, obstetrician, gonna pronounce it wrong, by the way. Ignaz Semmelweis, I'm going to call him Mr. I, or Dr. I, pioneered this insane notion that washing your hands between working with cadavers and delivering babies would reduce the number of new mothers dying. Yeah.
Would reduce?
Yes, would reduce it.
After working I'm just with
gonna,
cadavers.
Yeah, I'm having to.
It's cadaver. Or cadaver.
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 Okay. I knew that.
D. Yeah. So his theory was like, hey, guys, check this out.
I got a new fucking theory. How did he even like think like.
Oh, I'll tell you his theory. So and once he instructed his medical staff to clean instruments and hands with like a chlorine solution after like corpse handling, the rate of bed fever fell dramatically. So let's back up to see how he got to that conclusion. So he was like a man of his time, and according to Justin Lessler, an assistant professor at John Hopkins School of Public Health, it was a time Lessler describes as the start of a golden age of physician scientists when physicians were expected to have scientific training. Like before, they didn't have to have it. So they were expected at this point. Again, the year is 1850. So it's not like in the 1600s or the 1500s. It's like, you know, it's just that to me, I'm just like, okay, that's, I learned something. So,
yeah.
So, so doctors like Dr. I, were no longer thinking of illness as an imbalance caused by bad air or evil spirits because, you know, it wasn't the Jesus that was like gonna, that was cursing you and stuff like that. Like actual things were happening to you. They looked instead to anatomy. Autopsies were becoming more common, and doctors got interested in numbers and collecting data. So that was really freaking awesome.
That's good.
Right. So unfortunately, though, and shockingly, there were still some doctors like, whatever, dude. Everyone knows, like, it's God's vengeful will. Like, if they want to take the mamas and the babies, like, she probably was a whore. So that's probably what happened. So, anyway, so it took like a good while for the hand washing to catch on.
So the guy actually put,
meanwhile, they're fucking right. milking cows in the hospital room and getting listeria.
We'll also talk about not something like that. So it was interesting. So this guy actually put the scientific method to work to prove his theory, just to be like, guys, okay, I will prove it to you. So he studied two maternity wards at the General Hospital in Vienna. One was staffed by all male doctors and medical students, and the other was staffed by female midwives. And he counted the number of deaths on each ward. When he crunched the numbers, he discovered that women in the clinic staffed by doctors and medical students died at a rate nearly five times higher than women in the midwife's clinic.
But why?
Because girls are better.
I mean, just kidding. Let's be honest, but...
I mean, because we took care of things.
Well.
No. Well, yes.
First theory. Midwives had women deliver on their sides. And doctors had women deliver on their backs. He made doctors switch to delivering on their sides. No effect. So he's like, okay.
That can't be it.
That can't be it. Okay, so second theory. Every time someone had died on the maternity ward, a priest would come by with a bell. And this time, he theorized that the priest and the bell ringing so terrified the women after birth, they developed a fever and got sick and died. I'm dead serious.
Oh, the ego tells your mind some very strange things.
So, I mean, so shockingly, there was no evidence when he booted out there was no effect when he booted out the priest. Very shocking. He was shocked. So, and he was actually frustrated and he had to like leave town for a minute. So he's like getting more and more frustrated. And then one of his colleagues had died, and upon studying...
It had to have been the bell!
It had to have been the bell. Fucking cowbell.
Gotta have more cowbell. The only fucking prescription.
They got a fever. And the, you know, and it was the cowbell.
I don't know how this didn't work.
I don't even know.
It wasn't a cowbell.
Yeah. And upon, so one of his colleagues has died, and upon studying the symptoms of his death, he realized he died of the same thing as the poor mothers did. So now armed with the new realization that anyone in the hospital that could... Can catch the childbed fever, quote unquote.
Coronavirus.
So he went back to the drawing board. He also noted the big difference between the doctor's ward and the midwife's ward is that the doctors were doing autopsies and the midwives weren't. So he was like, Eureka.
Imagine that.
Crazy. He hypothesized that there were cadaver particles, little pieces of corpse that students were getting on their hands from the cadavers they dissected, and when they delivered the babies, those particles would get inside the women.
Great.
God.
Sick.
Who would
thank
develop...
Thank God we live right now.
Right.
Sometime, I mean...
Right.
Thank God we don't remember when we lived back then.
Right. So who would develop the disease and die? So he was like, hear me out. Like, let's try this for shits and gigs. Let's wash our hands before handling like a dead corpse before putting them inside a living.
What? Like, what are you talking about?
I said, like, that's what I feel like he was like saying to him. He's like, hey, guys, like, seriously, like, yeah. He was like,
that's crazy talk, Shay.
Like, right? Like, don't, what are you talking about? Like, before we put it in like a living, birthing person, just. The spritz, like, and
whatever.
Also,
it's just a body. We're all bodies.
It's one love. It's one love.
That was not what they were preaching.
No.
Also, I've also been thinking about this lately, which I need to probably stop thinking about. But like, obviously, there's always been things that like we find out later, like this is fucked up.
Right.
And obviously, we're finding shit out, like. Shit that we used to do when we were growing up that's fucked up.
Right.
But it's like, what are we doing right now that's like new that we're going to find out in like
right.
a bunch of like, you know, 50 years that's like, this was insane that this was happening.
I'm sure it's going to be all
motherfuckers,
it's going to be all the TV.
It's
going to
be
screen
like the
shit.
Internet and fucking
just like, oh my God,
podcasts.
They were giving themselves Kansas.
The Kansas all along.
All along. So, fucking Eureka, he nailed it. And the rate of child, like the bed fever fell dramatically after he was like, wash your damn hands. But implementing this practice was beyond difficult. Doctors were mad at this revelation because it made them look bad. Gotta love the good male, like the male ego, right? So, while right. So while he was,
it works. Sometimes. Yeah,
it doesn't
just like my lobotomies.
Exactly, gross.
But it worked sometimes.
Just like 45% of the time.
I was just nailing shin to someone's eye hole.
We just were passing it around.
Thought it was okay. I just need one more do over.
just 5 more do overs. He was just growing angrier and angrier because nobody was listening to him. He eventually lost his job because he was making so many enemies over hand washing. So
it's like, just fucking wash your hands, but bro. But
they were like, no. He actually
ended, you got wells.
Yeah, he actually ended up being thrown into a mental asylum. Because, yeah.
Trans-Allegheny?
Nope. He was over in Italy, so no.
Oh, no, no, no.
So
hey, they ship people over.
Maybe. I mean, back in the, I mean, that was around the same time.
World War II.
What was it? But this was like in the 18...
It wasn't World War II. I don't know what I'm talking about.
Okay.
What?
He actually ended up...
I don't know dates.
...being thrown into a mental asylum due to his rant and ravings. And there was speculation that he had contracted syphilis or Alzheimer's. Still not a great reason to commit anybody, but...
It was probably the Columbus Exchange.
It probably was. But he did end up dying there due to the fact he was beaten and then got septic. He essentially died the same thing he's fought like so valiantly for. So because probably somebody didn't wash their fucking hands.
Isn't it ironic?
And touched him, don't you think? Hmm. Obviously, washing your hands has finally become like a standard practice. It took a minute, again, which is insane. So like even when he was like he got fired, and he discovered like this like in 1849. It was officially like I think 1849 is like when he was like you need to like everyone wash your hands. It still wasn't implemented, like, years and years later. Like, they stopped actually doing it after he got fired. They're like, he's fucking crazy. Oh, it's obviously God that's taking these women away. So, they were just horrible women.
They'll learn eventually.
Right. In the next life. But even today, convincing healthcare providers to take hand washing seriously is a challenge. Hundreds of thousands of hospital patients get infections each year. Infections that can be deadly and hard to treat. The Center of Disease Control and Prevention says hand hygiene is one of the most important ways to prevent these infections. So, moral of the story,
we learned that in culinary school.
You would think, wash your damn fucking hands. So, I just thought that was interesting that it was just, you know, that was just a warm up or whatever. Mm-hmm. Poor guy.
Gotta wash your hands.
Just wash your hands when you're fucking dealing with dead bodies.
Who would have thought?
And then birthing babies.
Who would have fucking thought?
I mean, it's a conundrum, that's for sure.
Conundrum.
All right, so the next one. Okay, there was a moment in time where people tried to do animal-to-human blood transfusions along with animal milk transfusions for human blood. Yeah, that's correct.
Wait.
Yeah.
Milk.
You heard me.
Transfusions.
Correct. Yes.
For blood.
Yes. In the human body.
And they did that more than one time and realized it didn't work?
They did it
multiple times.
Multiple times.
Oh, what? I have to ask my mom about this.
Yes. Why? Your mom.
Just kidding. She's a nurse.
Oh, okay. It happened like not recently.
I know.
Okay.
Sorry, Mom. I don't think you were born in the 1700s.
I was like, Jesus.
When did but you I think just her... want to know if she knows about that.
Oh, yes.
Sure she does.
So let's back up to the 17th century when people were attempting animal to human blood transfusion. The first successful transfusion of blood was performed in the 17th century by a physician named Richard Lower. He had developed a technique that enabled him to transfer blood without excess coagulation in the process, which he demonstrated when he bled a dog and then replaced its lost blood with, like, that from, like, a larger mastiff, who sadly died in the process. The receiving dog recovered with no apparent ill effects, so he was probably like,
whatever, it's a dog.
Dude, I'm a fucking genius. This is ready to go. Patent acquired. Let's do this.
No more testing needed. We did this.
Bring in the first patient.
Let's fucking ride this train.
Right? So he went to the next level. later transfused lamb blood into a mentally ill individual.
I feel like I've heard about that.
Yeah.
In like AP Psych when I was an aide.
Right. With the hope that the gentle lamb's temperament would heal the man's insanity. The man survived, but the illness stayed. Shockingly.
Because
I just love the rhyme to the reason in it, though. Like, you know, you got to give him...
The gentle nature of the lamb is trapped in its blood.
I was on a field one day, and this lamb was just skipping about. And I was like, you know what? If we could just take the essence of that lamb and put it in this crazy man. Which
is clearly in its blood.
Clearly. Oh, my God. It just... It's insane to me. Okay, anyway. So, in 1667...
So when, like, the saying, like, it runs in your veins, like...
Yeah.
People just
There's, like, a lot of lore with that.
Temperament run through your... Well, I guess maybe genes and shit.
Well, there's a lot of lore with that, is, like, people, like, talk about how, like, vampires, like, they drink your blood, like, and they call it your essence. So, I guess, you know, there's some foundation to that.
Who knows?
Just saying.
How we interpret it.
Just
nowadays.
Saying.
What?
So in 1667, Jean, I'm going to pronounce this wrong too. Jean Denny's. I'm going to say Denny's. Why not?
The restaurant?
Yes. Just the, what is it called? Dennis. The Grand Slam.
Tutti Tutti Pancake.
Boof. Gross. I don't think I've actually ever eaten at a Denny's. Go me.
That's so really sad.
Is it though?
No, it's not.
I think I'm winning.
You're fine.
No,
You're not missing out.
He transfused the blood of a sheep into a 15-year-old boy and laborer. Both shockingly survived. But he did choose not to. But he chose not to perform human-to-human transfusions since the process often killed the donor.
One of them.
Yeah. So they literally had like a sacrificial lamb. And they were like, we can't do that to a dude, but we'll just, like, make it an actual lamb. So it's fine. It's like in the Bible. It's fine.
It's fine.
It's fine.
Poor little lamb.
So.
That's a quote from Dennis the Menace.
Oh, yeah, it is. I forgot. So yes. That was the reason. Yes.
Christopher Lloyd eats all the beans. And then they have to find the key.
He swallowed.
Yep, that's all. Okay.
So that was the reason why they weren't doing the human transfusions to begin with, because it was killing people, or it would have killed people. And they were trying to be like, all right, you know, we have like these horrible torture things, but we won't bleed them out. I mean, that's just taking it to the extreme. So,
We'll kill them by putting an ice pick in their eye or spinning them around too long.
Or just like...
Or fucking shocking them to death.
Putting them on the rack, but nothing like, you know. So... With all this talk about the viruses being, like, no, that was a different note. So sorry. Anyway, I was thinking in my notes when I was writing all these, I was like, with all, like, this talk about, like, coronaviruses and all this kind of stuff and how these animal to human, like, viruses are happening and it's killing people. Like, I just, with them injecting dirty animal blood into people, I am shocked that we're still even alive today as a species.
There's a couple of us around.
I mean, but honestly, though.
Yeah.
Like, I'm shocked.
We're a fucking resilient bunch, aren't we? Our bodies really heal themselves.
I guess
from
so.
A lot of weird fucking shit.
I mean.
Like, when someone puts sheep's blood in our body.
It's true, but like.
Without asking.
And, I mean, if they weren't washing their hands then, so it's just, again, I'm just thinking, it's just like, how, I just don't even know how, as a species, we've still survived.
Oh my God, then he's not washing his hands after he's touching the barnyard animals, putting blood in your body? Just fucking not washing your hands?
It's just disgusting.
The fuck?
Gross. Anyway, Denny's, I'm gonna call him that, ends up killing a couple of people due to these transfusions, and the French government, along with the Pope, were like, no mas. So... That size.
Pope had to get involved, huh?
He did. So that went dormant for like 150 years. When the study revived again, they still had the same problem of the difficulty with the preventing the blood from oh my gosh. My fucking nose coagulating.
Perfect.
From the blood from coagulating. So they were like, how do we change the blood? I got it. We just won't even use blood. We'll use milk. Duh. Like, that's a perfect binder. Right?
How does that make any fucking sense? Why don't we just put soda in our veins?
It's true.
The fuck?
In 1667, if they maybe have had it, they might have done that too. Yes.
Fucking mead.
Yeah. So it never coagulates. Cider. That's what they thought, because it never congeals. That's what they were thinking. And it's like it's got a consistency of blood. So that's what their brains were doing.
I mean, fucking science. You gotta fucking... Part of the process,
yeah,
the scientific method, right, which is fucking it's testing so a good hypothesis
at bringing ingredients together.
It's wrong.
It's so good at bringing ingredients together for food. Why wouldn't it bring the human body together as one giant muffin?
And then you just put yourself in the oven and you're fine.
And you're baked and you're good. So they got to work. The first injection of milk into a human took place in Toronto in 1854.
Fucking Drake!
Right. In 1854, so it really wasn't that long ago when this was happening. 1854.
Toronto, you guys, figured it out.
By doctors James Bovell and Edwin Hoder.
Bovell, like bovine?
Kind of, which Jesus is kind of funny.
Jesus Christ, that's a coincidence.
So they believed that oil and fatty particles in milk would eventually be transformed into white blood cells. They would just magically...
How is that even, like, a... Like, that's literally feeling like...
I had to read this, like, six times going, like, wait a minute. Like,
so this really lemonade thought, is right. going to fuel my car tomorrow.
Right.
And we're just gonna do it. We're just gonna put it in.
It's gonna be fine.
Just gonna put it right in.
And we're gonna make a wish. And it's gonna be fine. Like, they just thought, like, because of the oils and the fat, that it would just... That's what the white blood cells were made out of. So that's how it would
but
become a
thing.
Do
they even know what white blood cells were made out of?
I don't think so.
Well, maybe.
But they were just probably, they were hypothesizing. And they probably were like thinking like, okay, well, we're made out of fats and oils. And milk is made out of fats and oils. Well, surely it'll just turn into different kind of fats and oils. I don't know. Like, that's just what they thought.
And Jay, did you ask them?
I did. I had a seance, and I talked to Madam Wish Winchester.
And Mr. I.
It was great. Anyway.
Madam Winchester.
She told me to tell him. It was great. Okay, so they thought magic would happen.
She was like, sounds like he needs to build a house till right. he dies because he's crazy.
He's fucking crazy. They injected 12 ounces into a 40-year-old man, and he fucking survived.
And he died?
No, he fucking survived. So they were like,
wow,
fucking salt. Maybe. Fucking, patent acquired.
God,
done.
We're so fucking smart.
Right? We're so smart. But the next five patients died. So
what happened?
Short-lived.
12
ounces of milk.
So
I mean, that's a full...
12 like, ounces of blood was taken out of his body?
Like, he had lost blood. And then they were putting milk into him. So it's like somebody had, like, was losing blood. Because it was like, that was the biggest thing. Is like, back in...
How did he survive? Like, what happened
but you
to
know
his
what?
Body?
You know what it is?
Those... I wish we could go back in time and, like, study what the fuck was going on in his body that he was still alive.
Right? This body was just like, dude...
I guess 12 ounces isn't that much compared to, like, how much blood you have in your body.
It's not, but, like...
You can lose, like, 3 quarts of blood,
you
can't
you? You can, but, like, at the same time, you know, you just talked about it, how, you know... we're all different. It's like how some people can take pain more than others, and some people can like
some people can fucking survive off milk.
Some people can survive like over pneumonia than others, and some people have stronger immune.
That's
it's like
true.
And maybe this guy's body was like, can you not?
This is for science. I must survive.
Maybe I can just imagine just doing like, don't do that again,
moving.
But, like, dude, we're gonna, you're gonna be down for a couple days, but, like, dude, don't do that again.
He just, like doesn't talk
you
anymore.
You get one more, and then, but, like, we're gonna shut down, but then we'll be back, but, like, just don't do that again. We're gonna
use yourself.
So maybe he was just, like, a really good, just, specimen where he just, like,
he's a very good vehicle.
Right? Like, he just, like, could take anything like a champion where, who knows, like, I think the other five victims were, like, an elderly woman or like a child. So it didn't give any specifications on who the other five people were. Anyway.
Or they were already dead.
Or, well, no, they were alive. They were very much alive before they were injected with cow's milk. Anyway, so, despite these poor outcomes, milk transfusions became a popular method for treating the sick, particularly in North America. Hooray!
So, we know everything.
We do. Imagine the disclaimer today, though, like, if milk transfusions were, like, a commercial.
Got milk?
Right. No. Like the stupid, like, when you watch, like, in the commercials where it's, like, for, like, Prozac, and they give you, like, a laundry list of side effects. Can you imagine, like, just, like, take lactate, and, you know, it's...
You can't have a fucking milk transfusion if you're lactose intolerant.
Right.
Okay. Or you can, because...
Right.
Effects are different.
Right. Be aware that your intestines might explode, but...
Be aware you might start mooing and growing coarse, black and white hair.
Right. Or just, you know, your body will just start shutting down because milk is not supposed to be in your fucking blood vessels. Stupid.
In your veins.
Good God.
I mean, I drink a lot of milk and I feel like my veins are pumping with part vitamin D milk.
Right.
But
no.
I don't think that's real.
Right. So.
I don't think that's how that works.
No.
Okay.
So most of these patients were sick from tuberculosis.
Just put them in the tuberculosis ward.
Right, they're like, they're dying anyway. So, and after receiving their blood, like their blood milk transfusions, typically complained of chest pain, repetitive and involuntary movements of the eyes.
It's probably why we're lactose intolerant now.
Right, and and headaches. A few survived, but most fell comatose and died soon after. So, there you go. I'm not, again, sure why they kept injecting milk. But insanely, the practice was still not given up. It went back to the drawing board where one doctor, Dr. Joseph Howe, was like, maybe we just need to make sure we aren't injecting bad milk. True story. So he blood...
Make sure it doesn't have the listeria.
Right? Or like make sure it's not curdled. So he bled some dogs and attempted to revive them with the freshest of milk. Can you guess what happened?
They didn't survive.
Yeah, that's correct. They didn't wake up. Still didn't give up. This guy, like, had a fucking hard-on for milk. He was like, maybe human blood isn't compatible with animal milk. So he took 3 ounces of human milk, injected it into a woman with lung disease, where she promptly stopped breathing. But don't worry.
So now that your animal theory isn't working...
He's just going to, again.
It still is a valid, like, theory that it's milk that's working, yeah, even though it's not. But yeah, let's try it with human, even yeah, though the first time it worked was with, how does that make any sense?
It doesn't.
We've.
But it's okay. But she survived because he revived her with an injection of morphine and whiskey. So, dude, again, whiskey. What a time to be alive, man. Like, just no, fuck. This was like.
I just injected him with fucking milk. Just give him some whiskey. He'll be fine after that.
It'll buff out. So, thank God these shenanigans were over. Around 1884, the promise of milk as a perfect blood substitute had been thoroughly disapproved. By the turn of the century, Carl Landsteiner had discovered blood types, and a safe and effective method of transfusing blood was established. Thank God.
Good job, Carl.
Right.
He's like, we need to stop using milk to inject in people's veins.
It's true. Yeah, we need to not do that.
That's ridiculous.
It's true. So, lastly, this one is like, I'm going to do kind of like a cliff notes because I didn't know how long those two would take because I didn't want to be dragging it on and on. So, anyway, so this one was a little bit crazy because it kind of freaks me out. There was a theory that babies don't feel pain, and so they were not given anesthetic medicine in hospitals for procedures. And do you want to guess when or how long that theory was going on until?
The 30s?
1987. Dude. That's right after I was born.
Dude, that's crazy.
It's fucking insane. Insane.
87.
87. That's after I was born. 1,000%.
Jesus Christ.
Isn't that?
That's insane.
So, it was commonly believed until the 1980s that babies' brains weren't developed enough to process pain, which I don't really understand it because I'm like, they cry when you touch them. Weird. So why? Well, whatever.
I mean, maybe in a sense, but also no. No. I don't know why I even just said that.
So, thus most medical procedures performed on babies until that time were done completely anesthetic free. So, now it should be said, prior to the Second World War, surgeries performed on babies were often fatal. Physicians began to administer anesthesia to infants in the 1940s and 50s, but many infants experienced cardiac arrest and brain damage. Their tiny bodies just couldn't sustain the metabolic and circulatory effects of these anesthetics. So, discouraged, surgeons were like, you know what? They probably don't even fucking need it. And even if they do survive, they probably won't even remember it. It's perfect. Don't even worry about it. So, it was common to perform surgery on a newborn infant using no anesthetics or pain relief to prevent babies from squirming and thrashing around. Surgeons would administer a neuromuscular block, muscle relaxants, and so doctors essentially would paralyze their patients before surgery. Can you fucking imagine?
87. That's insane.
Yeah, 87.
I had to ask my mom about that, too.
You should. Yeah, isn't that fucking bananas?
Oh, my.
I mean, these poor babies, just have no way, can you imagine, though, being paralyzed and just you're screaming, but you can't move? Oh, God. Jesus Christ.
Those are my nightmares.
Yeah. Sick.
Wow. That's really fucked up and weird and crazy, and I literally have no idea.
I mean, medicine, thank God, has come so far. Research now indicates that infants not only feel the severe pain of such procedures, but they can be damaged by it shockingly, physically and perhaps psychologically. A major reason why these cruel...
That's their first fucking...
Memory
of trauma.
But I'm sure these doctors are they're babies. They're not going to remember anything. Fucking stupid. A major reason why these cruel and dangerous practices have gone unchallenged for so long is that parents have not been told about them. The consent forms parents sign to authorize surgery and other invasive procedures do not mention the possibility that pain relief might be withheld, and physicians rarely volunteer this information. So that's, because that was my biggest question. How did fucking parents be you know what? That's fine. Yeah, I don't, sure my baby's going to, Sign them off. Yes, and I'm sure, for open heart fucking shit, yes, I'm sure they're putting them under, obviously. But stuff like chest tube intubation and all this kind of stuff, I mean, they're not giving any pain relief like what adults get or even children get.
Yeah.
They're just, it's ripped out of them.
Oh my God.
Just circumcision. None of that. Oh, God. Anyway, so. That's so.
Sad.
Right. So, what changed all that? So, in 1985, what year I was born? A premature baby was born in Maryland who needed surgery to tie off a dangerous blood vessel near his heart. The newborn, Jeffrey, died weeks after the procedure. His family learned afterwards that none of the procedures had been performed with anesthetics. The only drug administered was a muscle relaxant. Can you imagine? Hey, I'm going to go rooting around in your chest cavity, but here's a Xanax. Take the edge off. Go to sleep.
God.
In 1987, the American Academy of Pediatrics declared that it was no longer ethical to perform surgery to preterm babies without anesthetics. Ugh. Somehow even today, not everyone is convinced. Some doctors still believe babies...
Well, the earth's flat, too, so...
Right? There you go. So some doctors still believe babies, especially premature babies, don't feel pain the same way as adults because their nervous system and or musculatural whatever system is not fully developed. So they just believe that their nervous system is not developed, therefore they can't feel pain. That's where their theory is and logic is coming from. Still, in 2014, a review of neonatal pain management in intensive care units in Europe found that newborn babies experience 11 painful procedures each day on average, but that 60% of these babies weren't receiving any kind of pain relief. So, hooray, shitty science facts. But hooray, Jeffrey's parents. So, but at the same time, still in 2014, it still isn't being kind of, it's again, it's like the hand washing thing. It's like the hand washing thing, you know?
Like shaking the baby, don't shake the baby.
Right. But it's like, again, it's like they just don't, they're not paying attention, or they're just like, they're so set in their ways, or it's an egotistical thing with doctors that
but
they don't.
But we know this.
Right. They don't.
But we've known this forever.
Right. They don't want to change. There's
things that change sometimes. Sometimes you learn new things.
And some people don't like change.
Learning every time.
It's true. Time after time.
Every week. If you fall, I will catch you. I will be waiting.
Time after time.
And just like we do time after time, yeah. We're about to roll.
We're going to roll.
Our dice.
That was a short one this week because I couldn't talk long because I was going
to
die.
Yeah, I don't want you to die.
No.
I don't need to shake you back to life.
No.
So guys, before we roll the dice, let me just say thanks for listening to us today. We hope you enjoyed our episode. If this is the first episode you've ever listened to, welcome. And if it's not, welcome back. And be sure to follow us on our Instagrams, @ 30ish, thurdysh. We put some funny stuff and post about our new episodes and
all the time.
Say weird things. And I found a new filter, Shay.
Oh, yeah.
Did you see it?
The one with the cat and the...
No.
It's a
snail face.
Oh, I did see that. You were having a good old time today with that one. That was hilarious.
So fucking weird. Anyways, we do face filter things and weird funny memes about being 30-ish and
we mean
about all our topics that and our areas of interest that we talk about every week.
It's true.
Anyways, thanks guys. Let us know if you have any cool stories you want us to cover. Still waiting for crime, so hopefully today we get crime. I get crime or you get crime. Crime after crime and time after time.
Ah!
You did it, crime?
I got a crime.
Doesn't matter.
Crime!
This is like a triple, double roll in a row.
Yeah. Destiny. I needed a crime in my life.
And I need this crime for my friend Jess.
I just need this crime in my life to wash up all the goodness.
For this.
I'm just kidding.
Hopefully I do this story justice.
Literally. Finger guns.
Yes.
Okay.
Justice.
I just needed a crime in my
life.
Shay
literally isn't stuffed up anymore.
No.
It's crazy.
I'm so happy.
I'm just kidding. She's literally just going to pass out smiling. She did.
I'm so happy.
Well, I guess we'll see you guys for another double fucking dose.
Double header.